Welcome to Let's Read the Books of Enderal. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading The Butcher of Ark, Volume 2, The Nameless One, which I found at an old farm. Chapter 2, The Nameless One. Up to the present day, the origin and nature of this vision has remained a mystery to me. Who was the enigmatic woman? How had she entered my thoughts? Or was it not her, but merely a spectral image conjured by my inner workings, an embodiment of my subconscious? These were the questions that went through my head after I awakened. Yet I had not much time to ponder, for when I awoke, breathing heavily and soaked in sweat, I realized that something was different. Disoriented, I pushed myself up and rubbed my aching eyes. I looked around the room, my bones cracking reluctantly as I turned my head left and right. Nothing. My surroundings seemed perfectly normal. Again, I let my gaze roam the narrow room, from the heavy wooden door over the small wardrobe to the scribe's desk in the right corner, on which numerous tomes and scrolls lay in disorder. Uncertainly, I closed my eyes and focused inward into myself. No. The repugnancy was not to be found in my surroundings. It stemmed from me. To be precise, it originated from a strange feeling in my stomach that was unknown to me back then. It was an uneasiness, dull and stagnant, a diffuse fear, similar to the one we experience when we know terrible or challenging things await us. Nevertheless, the feeling seemed familiar, a sort of gloomy truth which had been suppressed in my subconscious all these years and had now found its way to the surface, like glowing coal beneath a thin layer of fissured ice beginning to melt. Bewildered, I laid my hands on my stomach in an almost childlike manner. Of course it did not help. The strange, dull feeling remained. I rose dizzily and looked out of the narrow window above the scribe's desk. The vision had felt like an eternity, yet seemed to have lasted no more than an hour in reality. Still, not a single sound from outside reached my ear, and the light was dim and pale. Only a pallid, gray cone of sunlight brightened the dance of 100 confused grains of dust in the air. In addition to my inexplicable sense of uneasiness, I was nauseated, my eyes burned, and I felt weak. Water. I need water. I moved to the trough, which was filled with fresh spring water, next to the heavy wooden door. My uneasiness grew stronger, and an absurd fear took hold of me. What would I see in the mirror of the water when I bent over the trough? The deformed and decayed grimace I had seen in the ruin? Or the unremarkable face of a man who lived his life ruled by coincidence and lack of alternatives instead of free will? I fought the urge to back away from the trough and made myself get on my knees in front of it instead. My fear was baseless. No festering maggots crawled from the face that stared at me in the reflection. No chapped skin revealing the flesh on the bones beneath. Just a dream. It was just a dream. I smiled weakly and confused at my own folly, cut my hands to drink some water, and drank in deep gulps. Then I sprinkled some water on my face, rubbed it on my body, my hair, my arms, and my feet. I took the brush of boar bristles and scrubbed my skin until it started to bite. Finally, I took my brown priest's robe from the cast iron hook by the door, slipped it over my head, and leaned against the wall. I felt better, but not well. It was just a dream. I repeated the sentence several times in my thoughts in an attempt to banish the remnants of what I believed to be a nightmare. Yet the desired effect did not occur, for every time I closed my eyes, visions of my own corpse flooded me, and my uneasiness grew, as if it wanted to emphasize the dream's meaning. I sighed and did what I always did when I contemplated. I began to pace around my room. I remember all too well that this was the first time in my life that silence appeared oppressive to me. How I wished to hear the familiar creaking of cartwheels, the bright calls of the baker, or the bray of a donkey. But there was nothing, absolutely nothing to hear. Not even the mournful singing of the wind, which was usually omnipresent in Fogville. With the pale light in my chamber, I felt like part of a Termitralian morning tableau. Over and over, the same images flashed to my mind. The coffin, the corpse, the veiled woman and her words, "Follow the fire. End your false life." Was there a connection between these words and the dull feeling in my stomach? Why did I dream of such things at all? What, by the righteous path, did it mean? My countenance clouded. False life? What a heap of nonsense. I lived exactly the life the path had chosen for me. Even if, from time to time, gloomy thoughts occupied my mind, and I felt envious of the adventurers who took a rest in Fogville before continuing their journeys. It did not mean that my pious life was in any way false. No, I was lucky that I did not have to live by the side of my miserable father, smearing grease on animal hides. I was even luckier not to be one of the ill-fated people who cut each other's throats for a stale piece of bread in the undercity of Ark. I pinched the bridge of my nose, squeezing my eyes shut. These are the very thoughts that make path-abiding people stray from the path. They become attracted to an insane vision of an adventurous life and get drawn into suffering and misery. I recall the terrible stories which occasionally reached Fogville. It were always the egoists and those who hungered for power who dragged innocent people into ruin along with them. I dropped my hand and opened my eyes. No, my life is exactly as it should be. "Is that so, Jael?" I startled. "What in blazes?" Irritated, I moved around, trying to find the voice's origin. Nothing. I was alone. But then where had this voice come from? I must have imagined it. It had come to that. I was hearing voices. This dream is driving me insane. Angry with myself, I started pacing again. But after only two steps, the voice resounded again in my head, and along with it, the dull feeling in my stomach burned like a blazing fire in the wind. Images and feelings rose in my consciousness, heavy and pressing, but familiar at the same time. This time the voice spoke with a mixture of mourning and mockery. "How much longer do you want to close your eyes to the truth? What needs to happen to make you finally understand?" I tumbled backwards, not so much because of the words, but due to the sensation they triggered. Thoughts flooded through my mind like a flock of startled birds, and they did not only revolve around the scenes from my dream anymore. I saw myself lying on my bed, drenched with sweat, shivering. I saw myself gloomily staring off in the distance while Mater Palea read out the path to me. With these thoughts came a crawling uneasiness, a sense of loneliness and fear. Instinctively, I pressed both hands against my stomach. By the righteous path, I am losing my mind. Damn it, I am actually losing my mind. I turned around fast, like lightning, and hastened to my desk, upon which lay an open, leather-bound folio. It was a handwritten transcription of the path that had started just before the festivities of Star Summer Night. For 5 decades now, it had been possible to reproduce written works in an almost magical manner, thanks to the strange, press-like construction of a cunning starling researcher. It was called letterpress due to the mechanics of the machine. Manual transcription, however, was still considered a sign of spiritual commitment. There was something meditative about it. It was calming, which was what I needed to banish the rising panic. Hastily, I adjusted my chair, opened the inkwell, and took the quill. "Work frees the mind," I told myself. I was encouraged by the fact that the barrage of strange images and the feeling they brought on had subsided. It had been a dream, nothing more. A frightening dream indeed, but a dream nonetheless. Yes, concentrate, write a few pages, recite a verse, and the spook will be gone. Nothing will remind me of the disfigured body in the coffin of you, and tomorrow I will begin to continue my meaningless life. Indeed, it will be business as usual. Then one day I will die in peace, without having seen the truth at all, an insignificant pale number among thousands, and no one will ever remember you, Jael Tanner's son, the Nameless One, and... Only now did I realize that sweat was pouring down my forehead, that I was clenching the quill so hard that my hand was starting to hurt. The sentences I had written were scrawly and full of mistakes. I dropped the quill. Witchcraft! This is witchcraft! I slammed the book shut, closed my eyes, and attempted to clear my mind. like Matter Pylea had taught me. Breathe, Jael. Breathe. My entire body trembled. My pulse hammered in my wrists. There was no doubt that the voice came from within me. It was part of my thoughts, yet so unfamiliar, threatening, and lurking. "It is futile, Jael," the voice suddenly whispered. "You cannot escape destiny. End your false life. End it here and now, and follow the fire." There was a moment of silence. "Or else you will die." As the last word faded from my mind, fear exploded inside me. It shot up my spine and spread from there, to my heart, to my fingertips, to my skull, straight into my brain. Again and again I pictured the horror from my dream, interspersed with strange memories of seemingly random moments in my life. I saw myself pacing between the benches of the temple without orientation. I saw myself preparing a corpse for its last journey according to Enderalian tradition, weeping. I saw myself lying feverish in bed, breathing heavily and eyes wide open. But it were not the images which made the situation so unbearable. It was a suffocating sensation that covered everything like a leaden gray cloud, threatening to drive me insane. Fear and panic, bitter loneliness and desolation, I felt as if I was standing at the edge of a pitch-black abyss, lost and without identity. I felt alone. It might be hard for you to comprehend the description, but perhaps it helps if I attempt to explain how the human mind functions. If something terrible happens to someone, such as the death of a loved one, our mind reacts with a kind of shock. Only part of what we should be feeling is allowed to enter the immediate conscious experience. The rest is banished to the depths of our subconsciousness, buried like an unloved, dangerous secret. Once the mind has recovered somewhat, the banished remains of the memory will be unearthed, piece by piece, so that we can deal with them and complete the mourning process. If, for some reason, this reworking does not take place, the memories will decay and fester until their presence becomes noticeable. We feel gloomy, suffer from panic attacks, or lose the ability to feel emotions entirely. Though it is possible to live under such conditions until one dies, the buried memories consume much of our vital energy, and in the worst case, drive us to strange deeds. While the tentacles of fear raged in me, I realized that these terrible feelings were exactly such decomposing memories. They had been there forever, lurking shadows beneath a shield of glass. I had noticed them in brief moments, small and insignificant. Sometimes in the deepest of night, when I awoke from a nightmare, clammy with sweat and unable to recall what I had just dreamt. Sometimes in small fissures of thought which haunted me while I performed perfectly normal tasks. For a few heartbeats, I was filled with a misty, gray loneliness, and I felt as if I was an observer of myself, the spectator of a hypocritical, bigoted play. My false life. I lived a lie, a desperate attempt of my mind to conceal something in me that could not be concealed, a secret, something I had suppressed and could not hold at bay any longer. Now it had broken free, and remorselessly showed me what would happen if I did not begin to search for the truth. Death. You are dying. Yet some among you might realize that insights and actions are very opposing thoughts. Even though the voice had forced me to look at it, and I had looked at it, I did not want to accept it. I uttered a guttural cry, threw my writing utensils off the desk, and knocked down my stool. With my bare fist, I hit the wall of my chamber, ignoring the burning pain that shot up my arm. I wanted to banish the feeling inside me somehow, so I could get my old life back. But my resistance was in vain, and every second that passed amplified the panic constricting my throat, drowning me like an overpowering flood. Only when my breath was but a weak gasp, I sank to the floor, back against the wall, face buried in my hands, exhausted. It is futile. I felt the salt of my tears burning on my cheeks and sobbed like a child. What shall I do? By Malthus, what shall I do? I uttered with a shaky, miserable voice. For a while, nothing happened. Then I heard the voice again in my thoughts, tender, melancholic. You already know the answer, Jael. She told you what to do. This time, the voice did not aggravate my loneliness. No, for a moment, I almost felt secure, and in this moment, I made my decision. Yes, she was right. I knew what I had to do. I knew it, and had always known it. Yet like a fledgling soldier who did not understand that the tales about glorious wars were merely tales until he lost his leg, I had to see my own death in order to understand. I had to start searching for the buried truth. At the time, it was obscure to me what the veiled woman had meant by the fire. Was the fire a symbol of the truth? The truth behind the feeling of emptiness and loneliness I had learned to suppress and could not suppress anymore? The newborn man who later became known as the Butcher of Ark did not yet know that he would soon find the answer to this question. My memories of the hours immediately after my decision are only vague. It would be wrong to assume that the oppressive feeling in my stomach had vanished after I had gained insight into its nature. No, it was still there, and each time doubts surfaced while I was packing my belongings, it grew stronger and more present, like a master who was determined to keep a weak-minded student on the right path by using reprimand and sharp words. Yet I felt a determination I had never felt in my life before. Indeed, I felt a spirit of optimism, as absurd as it might sound after what happened to me. After I collected all my belongings, I left the temple, which had been my home for more than a decade. One last time I took in its awe-inspiring interior. There it stood, Malphus's stone statue, clad in a massive steel harness, looking ahead with determination. In his left hand the statue held a replica of broken chains, the right hand pointed forward, showing the way, proudly and full of power. One last time I closed my eyes and smelled the omnipresent mixture of incense, lavender, and roses, a scent which used to provide comfort. Now it tickled unpleasantly in my nose and reminded me of the ointment the inhabitants of the Isles of Kille used to embalm their dead. Swallowing heavily, I closed a door behind me. The contents of the satchel that hung over my shoulder were scarce. A loaf of fresh Enderalian bread, a water skin, my scratchy cotton blanket, a sachet of pennies, and the holy 101 verses, which I decided to bring along after a moment of hesitation. The book felt heavy, and its leather binding seemed rough and, well, sticky. Nonetheless, my attachment to the Lightborn, whose holy word formed the spiritual compass for any devout Enderalian, and who had been the only companion in my lonesome life so far, except for Mater Pelea, was too deep. One thing was clear to me. Wherever my journey would lead me, I needed food and decent clothing. My priest's robes were too heavy and cumbersome, and they would be too warm in the summer. They almost seemed like a burden to me, completely inappropriate for the task ahead. Even though every traveler, brigands aside, would treat me with respect, the robes were a symbol of my old life as a priest. So I had to visit the marketplace and find a trader who would sell his wares despite the holy day. It felt strange to see the place, that usually was full of people, so empty and quiet. Only a dog noticed my presence, plus a few chickens in corral surrounded by an alcove of the weak town wall. The sun had risen in the meantime, but the many gray clouds did not allow much light to shine down on the city. It was going to rain. Eventually I reached my destination, a small and cozy store. The house walls were overgrown with ivy, which framed even the milky windows beneath the crooked roof. A handcart full of barrels and crates in front of the entrance looked as if it had been abandoned by its owner during work, which was likely considering the smell of alcohol, gunpowder, and fried meat in the air. Garlands, which would have shone in all colors if enough sunlight had been present, hung limply between the houses. Several times I heard a crunch when I stepped on the shards of broken jugs. The sign next to the heavy door identified the shop as Carvey's Sundries. I knocked, and I knocked again when a few minutes had passed without any reaction. Finally, after the third round of knocking, I heard the sound of scuffling steps, and an aged starling with a clean-shaven face and a sharp nose opened the door. His tired expression told me he had intended to chase off the unwanted customer before he recognized me. The dark circles under his eyes betrayed he was likely among those who had vigorously celebrated Star Summer Night. Briefly, the sight struck me as bizarre, even familiar, as if I had experienced it many times before. However, the feeling was gone when the moment the merchant spoke, with a worn voice. "Well, father?" He glanced uncertainly at the embroidered emblem of a stylized eye and sword on my robe. Can I help you? I tried to smile. Indeed you can, by showing me your wares. May I enter? I was surprised by how confident and friendly my voice sounded. Carvey regarded me with sleepy confusion. Like all starlings, he was small and wiry, had frizzy hair and a pointy nose. Carvey was a path-abiding man. Every week he and his many children visited the three masses, which was the reason I had chosen his store to purchase clothes for my ludicrous journey. His respect for the clergy was great, so he would not ask questions. I did see the question why, by the righteous path, a village priest would visit a store this early in the morning on a day most people were recovering from a night of revelry and celebration in his eyes, but my estimation proved correct. He did not voice it. Instead, the merchant nodded devotedly, stepped aside, and let me in. Unlike the somber landscape surrounding Fogville, Carvey's house had a rustic and cozy feel. The fireplace in the large room at the end of the hall was crackling, and for a second I spotted a young girl peeking through a door at the top of the stairs on the right of the entrance. I envied the starling child and her siblings. Their father had given them a home and a sense of security I had never had with Gilman. When Pylea had taken me under her wings, it had already been too late. The wooden walls looked solid but old, and the large fur of a coast stalker hung on the left side. Reluctantly, I took a step forward and almost tripped over one of the many shoes on the floor. I heard the door behind me slam shut and Carvey clear his throat. "This way, Father," he said, and walked toward the large sales room from which I had heard the crackle of fire. It was an amazing sight. Behind the wooden counter, which separated the seller's realm from the customer's, numerous items, chests, boxes, and pieces of furniture were piled up. Huge bookshelves along the walls were filled with dusty folios, scrolls, crystals, and small caskets. The store looked insignificant from outside, but I suspected some precious antiquities could be found here. "Well, what exactly do you need, Father?" the starling finally inquired. I was unable to answer, taken aback by my own uncertainty. What did I actually need? I wanted to embark on a journey to find the mysterious woman from my dream, and I had a hunch that it might not end in Enderal. "Well," I started, "everything you need for an extended journey." Carvey's brows furrowed. "A journey? To where?" Apparently realizing his indiscretion, he quickly added, "If you don't mind the question." "I am traveling to Ark," I improvised. The longer before he would tell anyone about my getaway, the better. "The High Priest asked for us." That seemed to satisfy the merchant. "I understand." He lifted the hatch in the counter. "I am all the more honored by your visit to my store." I nodded and let him walk me through his wares. About half an hour later, I was relieved of 102 pennies. I had purchased a sturdy knapsack, a good pair of boots, a hooded traveler's cowl, and an old iron dagger, which I did not know how to use. Carvey had also sold me a traveler's staff he said was favored by pilgrims who visited the Seven Way Shrines. "It is perfect for repelling insects," he had told me trustworthily. As a farewell, I had blessed him and left with a priestly smile. I continued to the tavern to get provisions for my journey. The matress, defying his lack of sleep, was diligently cleaning up the remains of the festivities. He responded to my early visit with confusion as well, but after some explanation about my plans, he sold me a loaf of tasty bread, dried fruit, and a tub of pickled whisperweed, which is popular among travelers because of its durability, for a good price. He also asked for my priestly blessing, which I gave him with a strange feeling. The holy act felt more wrong than ever before, and the ceremony seemed not like routine, but a lie to me. The guardsman Vlaeus was the last person I encountered before I got to walk down the hill upon which Fogville was located. He was too tired to ask for my destination. Obediently, he opened the wooden gate and wished me to walk blessed. As I left Fogville behind, melancholic relief washed over me. Within a few hours, I had ended the life the veiled woman had described as false. Nobody would notice my absence until late in the day. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Enderal, The Butcher of Ark, Volume 2, The Nameless One.